Hi everyone, I'm doing this great shoot interview for Great North Wrestling on Hannibal TV show. And here I am, PCO Pierre Carl Ouellet, one half of the Quebecers, three times WWE World Tag Team Champions. And also I was Jean Pierre Lafitte, the great pirate, you know, who was undefeated for 8 months. And I had the world title championship match against Kevin Nash at the Montreal Forum. And I was also a WCW world champion in the hardcore division, and also a intercontinental champion in the IWA in Puerto Rico. So listen to this great shoot interview. You have a lot of juicy stories and a lot of fun. PCO, la 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 la.
We're with Pierre Carl Ouellet, who was three times WWE Tag Team Champions with Jacques Rougeau as the Quebecers, former WCW Hardcore Champion. He was in WWE also as Jean Pierre Lafitte, and he was an IWA Puerto Rico Intercontinental Champion and Quebec Champion. And you started wrestling very young. Did you always want to be a pro wrestler?
Probably since I wanted to be a wrestler probably since the age of 14 years old, I think, because at 12 years old I had the accident on my right eye. So my first goal was to be a pro hockey player, but since the accident happened and I got shot with a pellet gun, but with the name of the game is pick up sticks, where you have different colors of sticks. And we were like a bunch of kids just shooting sticks in our legs with the pellet guns, because we ran out of pellets. So we're trying to aim for the legs, but I put a knee down to hide under behind a counter, and it went straight to my eye. And I learned throughout the years, and even the doctors told me that usually you put a cup, you leave it there, you put a cup and you tape it to your head, and the doctors make a small incision and they remove it without damage. But since the two edges are rounded and it went through, when I pulled it out, you know, the eye kind of did that. So they saved my eye, but three surgery later, I was my sight was 10% on the right eye. So I had put a cross on the hockey career, even though I really liked hockey. They were both my favorite sports. Like before my practice of hockey, I used to watch wrestling at 6 a.m. in the morning going into practicing hockey. So it was not like a huge deal for me to change from hockey to wrestling, because I was in the mix of choosing which one I really want to do. But hockey was like there, but wrestling was there too, so it didn't change very much.
Who were some of your favorites when you were growing up?
I grew up with international wrestling mostly at the beginning, especially around my fourth and fifth grade. It was King Tonga, Rick Martel, Dino Bravo. You had the Road Warriors, who used to come in a lot, and Hogan was not known back then, but he used to come, and he was not drawing anything, but he was impressive to watch, but he was not one of my favorite. And you had in tag teams, you had the Rougeau brothers, and you had like not very very many other teams that were that great. The other teams were coming from the outside, let's say the Garvins, or, you know, they used to bring guys in for the Rougeaus. And I remember the Garvins was a hell of a feud with them. And then after that, the WWF came in on our channel here, and they signed, I think the first one they signed, first ones they signed was the Rougeaus, and then Martel went with Zinc as the Can-Am connection, because Zinc was like working the middle of the card for international wrestling, Tom Zinc. And then who else went? Joe LeDuc went, but he was not one of my favorite. Frenchie went as a manager. I thought he was funny as a manager with his voice and everything, but And Dino, when he went to WWE, WWF, whatever, they took his character away from being the big baby face that he was in Montreal. But was still, but the fact that he was a big monster and strong, you know, and he had like 7-8 years as a world champion in Montreal. So that carried like my, kind of a, my light for him, you know. And, but my favorites were Macho Man Randy Savage, Ricky Steamboat a lot, and the British Bulldogs. I liked to watch them. I thought they were quick, they were snappy, they were, I liked the way they worked, you know, it looked real good. And also another tag team that I really liked was like the Road Warriors in Montreal for international wrestling. They outdraw everybody. They outdraw every world single champion. When the Road Warriors came in Montreal, it's like they were drawing more than Dino himself. You know, they had to team up Dino with Ricky against the Road Warriors, and they would sell out like Montreal forums like many times. So they were just great. So just to say how much we liked wrestling also in grade fifth, just before college. We had to do a play in French, and I had a mate in the class that his name was Pierre Martel, so we made him Rick Martel. I played Hulk Hogan. We had a referee. We did the Mad Dog brunch because Mad Dog Vachon had a brunch with an interview, and then Pat Patterson had a brunch.
Because Mad Dog was in WWE for a while too, right?
I guess he was not really wrestling, but he was involved somehow because he tried to, he brought the Giant Gustav, someone who didn't really make it, but it was the biggest hands in the Guinness Book World Record.
Yeah.
And they tried to push him a bit. They tried to push Luke Poirier. Rambo was very, very, when I was in Germany for CWA, Otto Vance and CWA,
yeah.
Luke Poirier was the top man. He was the world champion. He was wrestling every big name at the end of each tour, like Vader, like Hawk of the Road Warriors. They brought him so many big names for him to beat that he was so over, and they said he was from France, but he was originally from Quebec.
Okay.
Quebec City, actually.
So he was in WWE too?
Yeah, and he came back in 1998 or 1999 as, I can't remember the name of the team, with Bull Buchanan. They had a tag team.
Yeah, they had...
Because they believed a lot in Bull Buchanan. They thought it was going to be like the future.
They were the military group, right?
Yeah. And Luke was part of that group. I can't remember the name because they were for a short stint, you know.
So prior to that, he was also in WWE with Mad Dog managing him, you're saying, like in the 80s?
In the 80s, they brought him in for like a couple of matches, maybe 10 matches, but didn't get over enough. So he went to France, and from France, he got hooked up with CWA in Germany.
Okay. That was, yeah, they were a team of military guys. There was like four of them, right? And Kurgan was involved with it too.
Later on, but they started at two guys, Luke and Bull Buchanan, and I have a tape here somehow where we beat them. And
we'll put the name up on the screen for them.
Yeah, they didn't get over as they would like to. And it's funny to see someone being so over like Luke. Like in Germany, he was a god, and for WWF or WWE, he couldn't really do it like there.
So how did you yourself actually start in the wrestling business? Because it was still a little bit guarded when you wanted to get in, I would imagine.
Well, when I started, it was like the end of the independent territories. I mean, I remember sending my stuff to Don Owens in Portland, Oregon, to USWA, to the Jarretts in Memphis, Tennessee, to Puerto Rico, WWC, the Colons, Carlos. That was the end. Like, they had nothing else in Florida. It was they were pretty all closed.
Was it Gino Brito that trained you?
No, it was It was Pat Girard. Okay. He was very known for training so many guys, like even Pat Patterson got trained from him, with him. The Rougeau got trained there. I guess every big names in the business got trained there at the Loisy Saint-Jean-Baptiste.
Oh, Ronnie Garvin got trained there too.
Everybody got trained there. I've heard it on different shoot interview that I've been watching on your channel, the Hannibal TV.
Yeah.
And I've listened to some of them, and I heard that the Loisy Saint-Jean-Baptiste, and I think Pat Patterson, they showed some bits and parts of his book Accepted, and I read that somehow in the Journal de Montréal, I think in Montreal, and saying that he started the Loisy Saint-Jean-Baptiste. And it's funny because I was trying to hide that from the WWF because I thought it was too small of a thing to talk about, you know, and everybody went by there, and it was very well known. But after that, I had like I perfectioned my craft a bit with Edward Carpentier in Montreal for 3 months. So I was always saying that Carpentier trained me, which is true too. But you know, after 2 years at the Loisir, I hit a plateau, and I just wanted to get better. And I had the chance of training for free with Steve Strong, Dan Crofat, who was Phil Lafon, who was very over in Calgary and in Japan.
Yeah.
And my Hex tag team partner, Nelson Veilleux, he was training with Edward too. And we're like six or seven guys who really, you know, took wrestling seriously or really wanted to make something out of it. And training with those guys who were already pros, Strong and Crofat, I think that was very good. And with Carpentier, who at his feet and as a commentator in the WWF. So I thought it was going to be all good. And then apart from getting some contacts and getting better, a little bit better from there, I mean, that Edward never did anything for me. Basically, he didn't pick up the phone or try to hook me up. You know, I did it all by myself, basically.
So you spent some time in Stampede Wrestling when you started, right?
Yeah, that was horrible. You know, I was not speaking English at all. I started wrestling at the age of 16 at the Loisy for 2 years. I had maybe three victories in 2 years. I was jobbing every weekend. And I got pretty discouraged, so I wanted to get out of there and try to make yourself, you know, make a name for myself. And which was tough, is because I was hearing stories from the guys there. Because the Loisy Saint-Jean-Baptiste, you had the guys who wanted to make it and the guys that made it but still loved the wrestling and wanted to have like 5 or 10 minutes of glory, you know, every Sunday afternoon and just, you know, meet the boys like Johnny War Eagle, Dan Ferris, Black Diamond, just some guys who had been on the road. And UFO was Bob De La Sera, and guys like that, they were telling stories in the dressing room about how it is to be on the road and how it is to be in Germany and wrestling at the same place for 60 days or travel with the boys, and guys that were reading books, others were going out and different stories. So I really got curious, and I really wanted to hit the road. So I was trying to call Stu. I had my friends who was bilingual at the time, and it was telling me some words what to tell him, but you know, I was really bad. So I just decided to buy my own ticket and flew there. And with no English at all, it's nothing. And I got to the...
And there's not many French people in Calgary or Alberta. Like,
not that many. No. And I went to Stu, and I said, "Yeah, Stu, I'm a wrestler. Maybe me wrestle tonight." And he showed me the bathroom. He said, not yet, kid, you know. So I figured that he was telling me to go have a shit or something, because he didn't talk very long to me, and he didn't show me the dressing room where I could get changed and have a match. So it was horrible.
Did they offer to train you at all? Or?
After a while, but what I was doing, I found a little family, a poor family, with the Salvation Army. So it was cheap for me to stay there for like maybe $30 per week. And I stayed with them, and every Friday I was going to the Stampede, and then they were telling me, no, but they were ribbing me. Take your bag and go to Edmonton. We might have a guy that won't show up or is going to be injured, so we might use you there in Edmonton. So I would take the bus for 4 hours, go to Calgary to Edmonton. Then in Edmonton, I would go see Bruce or anyone
Bruce
of the boys.
Was Bruce the booker then?
Yeah, Bruce was the booker. And then they were telling me, no, but maybe next Friday in Calgary. So they had me going back and forth Edmonton and Calgary. And eventually, Bruce got fed up with me showing up all the time, so he offered me like a tryout in the afternoon with a green boy, you know, another guy. And I thought I did pretty well, but he was trying to sell me a school for $3,000.
Yeah.
And I totally refused because I had the base, you know, I just needed to work, and I said no. And he told me that I was never going to make it, but that was bad and the shits, whatever. And I eventually left and came back.
Was Chris Benoit there at that time?
Yeah, he was one of my favorites on Calgary Stampede. He was my age, and he was like 17, 18, and he was one of the top boys with Owen. Owen and Chris, they were like really a good tag team there, and even in singles, and they were working against a team from Viet Cong Express, and they were having some great match, and they had the whole Viet Cong thing. Makan Singh was...
Oh, the Karachi Vice.
Yeah, Karachi Vice, Makan Singh, and the other Indian guy.
Gamma Singh,
and I mean, and then you have the two strong men that were there too, Bill Kazmaier and Ted Arcidi. And after we saw RCD on WWF, but it didn't really make an impact there, but it was impressive.
He had a memorable appearance on Piper's Pit.
And the only guy who really took care of me in Calgary was Kerry Brown. Like, he felt kind of, he was human, you know, he was trying to help me out. He told me, he said, don't stay here, they're not going to use you, they're just fucking with you, and, you know, just try to go somewhere else, get more experience, and maybe eventually you'll be able to come back here. But he was really nice to me, Kerry Brown. And that's what I did. I came back to Montreal after 4 or 5 months of trying there in Calgary, and nothing happened. And I was really kind of depressed. And then I started sending my stuff to Dupre's in the Maritimes. And then I did some shows in Montreal, and I ended up with a pretty good spread in the local newspaper, saying Carl Ouellet working with Dino Bravo, Gino Brito, and some of the big names. But I was doing jobs, but since it was a local newspaper, you know, my picture was big because I was the guy from the little city working with the big names. So I guess when I sent that to, sent it to Emil, he probably thought I was one of the main guy in Montreal. So he hired me and called me once, said, do you know if Crawford is coming this year? And I said, no, I just work with him, with Edward. We train, and he's going to Calgary. He told me he was starting on the 22nd, I said, something like that. But I didn't know, but he was asking about Nelson Veilleux, which was Bob Crawford over there.
Okay.
So I kind of screwed Nelson thought I screwed him. Yeah. In purpose, but I really didn't know his name in the Maritimes. I really thought he was Nelson Veilleux.
Yeah.
I didn't know he was Bob Crawford, and you have the other name, which is Crawford, Crawford, and with Emil, you don't really understand much, you know. Yeah. He speaks funny, even in French. It's like it's a mix of French and English and Cajun, you know. So it's kind of tough to understand anything. And I was so happy that I was getting a break there, so I really didn't think about anything else. I said, no, Crawford is going to Calgary. So I was there by myself, and they put me in a tag team with Eddie Watts. They put a hood on us. They called us the Super Bees.
Okay.
And we were working right on top against Masa Chono, who was Tokyo Chono there.
And, oh, from New Japan.
Yeah, from New Japan. That's cool. He was a young boy, yeah. So I was working every night, Chono, and the booker was Bulldog Bob Brown. So Bob Brown was probably 55, he was old, couldn't bump, couldn't do much, was doing all the talking on the mic. Chono was not speaking a word of English. And we were doing like a championship match, you know, for the titles all over the Maritimes. And I was screwing up big times, like I made big fuck ups in every match. Because my English was so bad, so he was calling me a baseball slide. I couldn't hear it. I couldn't hear it. Bob Brown called me baseball slide, drop kick. I came back over the ropes. I fucking bear hugged him, you know. I said, what the fuck? they kind of hated me. And I had a great match was with Sailor White. And Sailor White had the reputation to beat up all the job boys. Yeah. He killed them, like really opened
Didn't
it up.
Didn't he beat up Billy Robinson once?
He had a very, very strong reputation for beating up people, you know. And me, it was light as a feather. He liked me. He gave me I backdropped him. He made me look like the champion of the territory. So the Bulldog Brown, the son, who wasn't a wrestler but was on the road, like an agent or something, and Emil and everybody came in the dressing room. That's how you got to wrestle every night. But what? Well, but he made me too, you know. It's like, it was me, but it was him too a lot, with the size and everything.
Yeah.
So he made me look good, but I did the right thing. The timing was there, so... For myself, I saw hope that I could do something good. Even though it was not going my way, I felt that I could do something pretty good in this business. Then eventually, a month after, Nelson finally came in, and then Nelson Bayou, he joined the second wave because we had two crews. So we had two crews working every night. And we had TV there, so TV shows, TV tapings in the big arenas. Crowds were pretty good. And so I just left my apartment, and we shared an apartment together, me and Nelson, and my morale was getting better. And sometimes in single matches on TV tapings, they put us against each other, but me being as one of the top babyface of the company, and Nelson was like working at the bottom there, so we threw some good matches on TV, and got along good with Eddie Watts, but was not good enough to keep my spot there. We got released, me and Nelson. We got released the first ones because they came at the end. They cut one crew, but we were the first one to let go. So came back here in Montreal with another slap in the face, basically.
Yeah. And then you went to England for a bit, is that right?
Yeah. Well, I was so down from this trip, you know. It has been so tough mentally, morally. The fact that it didn't work out again, and trying very hard to make it. I decided to go back and play hockey for a couple of years at the College André Laurendeau in Ville La Salle, which is a high level of hockey. And after my second year there, I got to play in the Nationals for the seniors. For it's called in Quebec, it's called the semi. It's like the semi pro, but there's a name for that. But it's for over 22 years old, but you're a professional, you're getting paid, But it's under like American league, you know. It's like a goon league a little bit. But there's a lot of talented player too. So we played in Almonte, not too far from Hawkesbury, I guess. Quarterfinals for the national championship and the senior AAA, if you want. Championship and we lost, but I kept the score sheet. I did good. I scored some goals and I was one of the best players of the team. And they were all former players of the NHL or guys in a young age trying to make it to the NHL. So it was a very good caliber. And here it's called the North American Hockey League in Quebec. And everybody's getting paid, and so I made the star team of that year, going to that championship. They took the best players of all the province and made a team of all star, going to that tournament. And but we got eliminated. But got a phone call for an International Hockey League, which was the farm club of the Chicago Blackhawks. It was the Indians of Fort Wayne. And Al Sims, a former hockey player in the NHL, was the head coach. He called me up himself because I sent him the score sheet with also saying I had another career in pro wrestling. So I guess they got interested in the fact that I was looking pretty big at 240.
Yeah.
And pretty muscled up and everything. And they thought maybe I could drop the gloves here and there. And
yeah.
Play a rough game, so and being able to score some goals, but I turned it down. And in between the times, I met the farmer Louis Laurence. I don't know if you heard of him.
I've heard of him.
He was one of the bottom guy from international wrestling, and he was the one who was setting up the ring for them, the rings.
Okay.
So I told him about my dream and everything, and he hooked me up with girls in Toronto. Tracy, it's been a while, I can't remember, Tracy Joy was her name. And anyway, she booked me on a show in Toronto, and I wrestled a green boy by the name of Steve Irwin. And his father was working in England for a real company, and he heard about All-Star Wrestling in England with Brian Dixon.
Yeah.
So he got his son booked there, and I got in touch, kept in touch with Steve, because his first match was against me, and he did very well. Very well. When I look at the match today, it was a shitty match, but back then we thought it was a great match, you know?
Yeah.
So for his first match, and me not having much experience, I thought I gave him a good first match. So,
yeah.
But the psychology wasn't really right, but it was a decent match, you know, it didn't look bad. So he was happy about it, and he said, you should call Brian. I talked to him about you. He would use you here in England. So I called my buddy Nelson. We made some pictures. We start working as a tag team. We called ourselves Double Trouble, and then we sent pictures there, and I was handling all the details, the phone calls and everything. And Brian called me back a few times, and we got hooked up with him. And we got there. We got there. The territory was really bad, very low. And we were working Robbie Brookside and Doug Dean, their best tag team there. But in our mind, you know, we never seen such small guys. We were used to see the WWF guys, the international wrestling champion guys, you know, all, you know, over 6 foot tall, and, you know, big bodies and good shapes, and or huge monster, and they were pretty skinny, but they were over like crazy. So we worked them every night, and we tore the houses down there, and the house, they started to go up. And I don't know if probably just wasn't us, was probably a matter of the roller coaster of the business going up in the meantime. But by the end, you know, by after 3, 4, 5, 6 months that we were there, houses were like, we were wrestling in front of 2,000 people in Leeds. the Croydon Royal Albert Hall was almost jam-packed when we were going there in London. All the venues that we did, some theaters, you've been there, you know mm-hmm. how it is, was packed, like, and it was empty when we got there. So we asked for a raise. We asked Dixon, George, Brian, Brian, George Dixon for a raise, and he really doesn't like that. But we were getting paid £20 per match each,
right?
Which was about $40 back then. 7 days a week, probably 25 days a month. You know, working a lot and a lot of traveling. You know, 7-6 in the car with his girlfriend on the front seat, or his best wrestling girl, whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm. I want to see his girlfriend because I'm not sure, but she was taking the front seat while we were like three buddies of 300 pounds in the middle of the seat in the back.
Yeah.
Looking for hair. It was tough, plus the merch in the back of your head. So yeah.
Not stopping to go to the bathroom very often.
Not stopping to go to the bathroom and trying to make it as quick as possible. And made a lot of good friends. It was a good experience. And from there, Brian told us about a company in Germany called, they didn't have really a name. It was René Lacertes, who used to run Hamburg for 40 some days. And then some of the names that went through there was Chris Jericho was there. Because me, I did Hamburg, I think I did it once or twice. Maybe twice, I'm not sure. Once, I did it once. And Peter Williams, who was Hotto's partner, came to see me wrestle because while we were in England, they did some shootings in France for TV tapings for Eurosports. So all the boys from Hotto, Chris Benoit, Owen Hart, Rambo, some big names, Larry Cameron, who was in the AWA, yeah, died in the ring there while I was there in Germany. But just before I got to...
Oh, you were working that night when he passed away?
Yeah, I was there. I was there.
What was the cause of death? A heart attack?
Yeah, heart attack. Yeah, it just collapsed in the ring.
And did they continue the show?
Yeah, they didn't really know what happened. They just sent him to the hospital and they realized after that it was a heart attack. They thought it was just might be unconscious or something. They didn't really tell the boys what really happened, but even the crowd didn't know what was going on. It's not like someone falling off the roof of 50 feet and hitting the top turnbuckle. When someone just collapsed, you think it just has a seizure or something that doesn't go well, or he's gonna throw up or he's sick. So it didn't really look any bad at all. So it's just the next day that we learned that he had passed away, basically, or during the night.
And how did you end up in Puerto Rico?
That was after me and Nelson worked a lot in France. So Hotto and Peter Williams, they could see us on TV all the time. So we sent our resume to Hotto from England. We sent it from René, because Hotto was running 6 months a year, four different towns. And then I just had the habit that everywhere that we were going to a different territory, I really have to say that I met a guy named Peter Harmeller, who was a Mongolian mauler, and he was the perfect prototype of the indie wrestler trying to get booked everywhere in the world. Like, he had been in India, so many countries. And he was telling me, like, proper planning prevent piss poor performances. So he had that. He had like all kinds of things in his mind. He was, you know, like really intelligent but crazy at the same time. And he was something else. He was a character just in himself. You know, he was It was like getting all the boys crazy. Did you see my match? See how over I was, how the people react to me? And it was just like loud and funny and telling jokes. But I learned a lot from this guy. So every time we went to England, I was sending packages to all the promotions all the time. So every time we hit Germany, sent packages for me and Nelson everywhere. So we got booked in South Africa and Cape Town and the other big city there. But we never worked there. We landed there where Nelson Mandela is from.
Johannesburg.
We were flying there and then to Cape Town and different other towns. So we did three tours in South Africa, me and Nelson. And we were the South Africans tag team champions too. So
you're getting a lot of experience.
It was good working at the Good Hope Center in Cape Town in front of 8,000 people. And I was getting good crowd experience there. And working with top guys like Donnie Britz, which in my book, one of the best in the world, but he never got to show his talent here in the WWF or anywhere else, but he was great. Mm-hmm. And we worked also with the son of the promoter there, so Sean Kuhn. Promoter was Jackie Kuhn, and he died eventually, but they're still running. I think Sean's still running for his, you know, he took the territory from his dad and runs it. And he came to work with us in Germany for Lasseter. So anyhow, I thought Otto Vance really liked the big guys, and I think they thought that Nelson might have been too small. He was like 5'8", but he was good looking, like 240. He looked that part. He was not to me. It was not any shorter than Chris Benoit. You know, they were pretty much the same size. So I couldn't really understand why they wouldn't want to take him, but after a discussion one night, me and Nelson, he decided that if I had a break, if I could go there, he was not going to make a big deal out of it and just say, oh, we were a team, and then you want to go by yourself. And he was really sports about it, and he said, you know, if it's going to happen for you and it's not going to happen for me, just go for it. So I went and worked for Otto, and I've had sent packages for me and Nelson to Carlos Colon for almost 3 years now. When I met Rip Rogers and working for Otto Vance, who was already been working for Carlos, and I don't know, like sending stuff and things. And eventually I got back from my tour in Bremen, which was finishing December 30th. And January 4th, 1993, my phone rang, and it was Carlos himself telling me that he wanted me to join and take the next flight and then the next day. So January 5th, he called me on the 4th. He said to get a flight tomorrow and come here, we'll use you. So it happened so quickly, and they called me. But I had called for 3 years for me and Nelson. They knew who I was, and I was sending my pictures from Germany, from England, from South Africa, from... So they knew we were busy, you know?
Yeah.
And I don't know if Rip had put a words to him that he saw me in Germany for Otto, but just called me, and I went there, and it was kind of tough because they were behind with the payoffs, you know, like some of the guys hadn't received the payoff in 6 weeks, 8 weeks behind.
Right.
So when I first got there, I got paid every week, and then eventually they stopped paying me like the others. So me, I didn't do like the others, you know. I just I took the flight the next day. I didn't tell anyone, and I left. I came back to Montreal 2-3 days after. Carlos called me back because I was in the middle of a program with Invader, Jose Gonzalez, the guy who stabbed Bruiser Brody.
Yeah.
So I was working a program with him when I left. So Carlos called me. I said, Carlos, I said, I can't live, you know, without money. I have to eat, I have to train, I need my payoff every week. And now I'm like 4 weeks behind. So I need you to pay for my plane tickets. And I need you to, as soon as I get there, get my 4 weeks that you owe me. And it was a little bit scary when you know what happened to Brody. He said, are they calling me to give me a beating and sending me back in Montreal for having, for, you know, leaving the territory, yeah, you know, in the middle of an angle, or they really want me back and they're going to use me. So
because you were actually working with Invader too, right?
Yeah, so, yeah. It crossed my mind, but I decided I was going to hop on that plane. So from GFK and changed to LaGuardia. It was a cheap plane too. Yeah, I had to go with my bags from GFK, take the bus to the LaGuardia, from LaGuardia to Puerto Rico. It's a long day too, but it's okay. You know, you're starting in the business, you know, and you don't expect the first class all the way. So got there, got my money, got paid every week. Eventually, we heard like they were bringing some guys from WWF, some big names. So I heard that the Mountie was coming to work Carlos, and I was gonna work in the semi-main event against Jose Invader One. So Jacques came in for maybe a week. So he was presenting himself in Spanish because he speaks Spanish a bit, because his mother used to go 6 months a year in Mexico. So he goes in Spanish to all the Puerto Rican wrestlers and the English wrestlers, introduce himself in English, and he came up to me and I said, hey, Jacques, comment ça va? So in French. So he got really surprised that I was there, and he never heard of me. He didn't know I was existing. So kind of started watching my match and things like that. And he asked me if I had a tape. So I had put a tape of me and Nelson in different tag team match, a 8-minute tape. So showed him the tape and showed him some of, we had some highlights, you know, Nelson highlights move, my highlights move and things like that. So showed him some of my highlights move and things like that. So got really impressed with that, and asked me if I wanted to go to the WWF. After a week or 2 weeks, I think he came once or twice, pretty close, and the trips were close. He had took a year off from WWF for his son, JJ, who was 5 years old. He wanted to be there for his birthday and spend some time with his family and things like that. So
that was after the Mountie, right? He'd already done the Mountie.
Yeah. So Pat Patterson called me, Surgeon Slaughter called me after he had spoke with Vince, Jacques and Vince. They all called me, and they all set up like two matches for tryouts in Charlotte, in the Carolinas, and another city, South Carolina, Charleston. One in Charleston, one in Charlotte, and it was two nights in a row. I worked both nights. Jim Powers, who didn't want to help me at all, like just wanted to do his regular match, so I couldn't really get my stuff in.
What was the rumor with Jim Powers and Pat Patterson? Was there any truth to that?
Well, there was so many rumors with Pat and different boys. It's a, you can't even really go to the end of that story, because you don't know what happened, you know.
If but Powers just was one of the ones that was always in the mix. There was a rumor. Right?
Yeah, he was trying to get a push from the back, I guess. I don't know, no. But, no, but, but Jim, Jim is a good, yeah, after I did my tryouts with him, which I gotta say, he did work good, but he didn't really spice it up, you know. Match, we were both the same, two nights in a row, it was a blueprint copy of the first match.
Right.
Nothing changed, you know, clothesline of the second, leapfrog, leap toss. It was the same old match, but it was enough, I guess. They've seen enough that they decide to hire me, so. And I don't know what happened while I was not there and what they were saying. I don't know if really, you know, Jacques, the way Jacques told me things, it's like they decided to put us together. Like he never said, like, I would like to work with this guy, you know, and we think we could be a good tag team. So I really don't know the backstage, you know, talking, you know, because me, I was still doing my things in Puerto Rico. Then I got to, Victor Quinones booked me the wing in Japan. I worked there with Hugh Morris, Bill DeMott.
Yeah.
He was my tag partner in wing in Japan. We were Bash and Crash.
Okay.
And with the makeups looking like the Road Warriors a little bit. And when I came back from Japan, you know, I was calling Jacques, you know what happened, you know what they're saying. It's gonna come, something will happen. They told me something will happen. They're just looking at names, looking at things, looking at gimmicks. They couldn't use the name, it was supposed to be the Mounties, but because of a lawsuit, they couldn't do that. So they were thinking maybe calling us the Canuck.
Yeah,
which we thought no,
because there was the Royal Canadian Mounted Police were threatening to sue WWE or something because they didn't like the shock stick
and the image that it was portraying.
Okay.
So
so the Canucks.
Yeah, they want to say they tried different names and they ended up with the Quebecers, but I wasn't any parts of that, you know. And my name, why Pierre, you know, I guess Pat Patterson's real name is Pierre Clermont. They thought Carl was too English to have a French version for the heat, I guess. I don't know, they wanted me to speak French, but I think it was a little bit of Jacques under that too, like keeping like all the mic for himself and me saying just a few things in French. And anyway, it's good, you know, the French is good, and people hate you, you know, we got heat with that, but it was, you know, didn't get a chance to really work my skills there behind the mic, so it was a good break, but it was a tough break in the one year. It's good, you know, like I respect the fact that the veteran gives you a break, and in the ring it was really like 50-50, but in all TV interviews and all TV shows in Montreal was 90%, 10%, you know, it was basically the post, so, which...
When did they throw Johnny Polo into the mix?
Well, somewhere in the middle, but I really liked Johnny, but Jacques didn't really like him, so he had to travel with other guys. He couldn't travel with us, so we were traveling. we were traveling together, me and Jacques, and I think Johnny kind of hated that the fact that we're renting a Cadillac, you know, or a premium class car, and we don't bring our manager with us. It's kind of tough for the chemistry of the team, I guess. But
why did Jacques hate him? Was there any specific
reason? He just didn't want to get mixed up with any of the boys, really.
Okay.
He just wanted to stay out of problems, I guess. Was kind of smart too, you know. I really don't know what.
Did Polo like leave the group on his own eventually?
No. It was all Vince calling the shots. You know, he went from us to being Adam Bomb's manager too.
Yeah, because that was a good, I always thought that was a good character. He always
it was supposed to be good for interviews, but he couldn't talk much with Jacques, you know, doing most of the interviews, so he couldn't really show his skills. So it was you know, he would have his 10 cents there, but that was it, you know. He didn't have much. And when he had good ideas, sometimes, you know, Jacques would agree with it, but it was a tough for me, I was caught up in the middle. Like, I really, I liked Sid Vicious a lot, you know. I got along good with him, but I couldn't really bring him with us or travel with him. So I was kind of stuck in the Quebecer thing.
Why does Sid get such a bad reputation? I'll just ask that now, because in our deal, like, of course, I've dealt with him a lot, and he's always been a pleasure to deal with, but you always hear such horrible things about Sid from people.
I don't know. Me, I consider him to be my best friend ever in the business. Like, we had so much fun together. Like, recently, one of the girls that we met during some different tours in Germany, she had been back in touch with me. She's a flight attendant now for a big company. She's coming in Montreal and at the end of the month, and I'm gonna have a dinner with her and whatever, you know, an evening, just going to eat and just tell stories, you know. And she taught me and said we were really nice and gentlemen and really never, you know, did anything wrong to anyone. And even being drunk or whatever, we were just having fun. I mean, I really never saw Sid losing it, you know, being drunk, except if somebody was really looking for it. Like, let's say we were walking in Memphis for, I think Sheryl Crow was the singer there, and it was like someone just keeping bugging his wife all the time, and I saw him snap there, but the guy was just after his wife nonstop, and hey, Sid, this, Sid, oh, your wife's looking good, and I like your wife, and he snapped there. You know, he was snappy at some points, but for a reason, you know. Yeah. But with me, we never had an argument, me and Sid.
What happened with that Arn Anderson thing? Did he ever tell you the behind the scenes?
Yeah, he told me his versions.
Was he just being harassed into it, or was it just
that
all
to me?
Alcohol?
He said that Arn started the whole thing. Arn was the first one to try to stab him with the little scissors. Because it started at the bar,
right?
Where, you know, they were saying that Flair is too old. You know, he should get out of the business.
Because Sid was a horseman then, right, or something?
He was just Sid Vicious, okay. I guess. And it was in England,
okay,
in Europe anyways, and it's just bashing Flair basically, and Arn got involved saying, hey, you should respect the guy and blah blah blah. I told Arn to fuck off, you know, and go back to your room or something like that. And on his way back to his room, Arn's doors was open and started to get at it, like verbally with Sid, and reached out for like little scissors, and I think Sid grabbed it off his hands and stabbed him like 13, 14 times.
Yeah.
But,
messy situation.
Yeah, yeah. But I didn't go to jail, and and eventually, like maybe 5, 6, 7, 8, a few years after, they worked it out. Like they came to talk to each other again.
And so, what was the incident with Pillman, the infamous squeegee incident? Did he ever tell you about that?
No, with Sid and Pillman.
Yeah,
never asked him. I didn't know.
That's
the things that I didn't heard. Like, if say I didn't heard, like the thing with Arn, I've heard about it.
Yeah.
So I asked him.
Yeah.
Because I was so close to him that I could ask him probably anything. Like, he was close to, he knew like my sister had leukemia, and he was very close to my family, to my mom and dad. You know, he was almost part of the family. And I was like, when I went to work for Power Pro Wrestling, which was like the NXT back then of the WWF in Memphis, I just stayed at his house. First, I rented a condo, and then eventually he said, just come to my house and just live with the family. So I was there. His wife was nice, generous, you know, like had a maid there. helping out with the kids and everything, and we were going to the gyms every morning and working out twice a day. And then Power Pro, we had like maybe 3-4 shows a week. You know, it was not a full schedule, you know, so it's pretty some time off there. So took care of me there, and had this phone call right when I was there at his house. Eric Bischoff called him for offered him the big deal for WCW.
Oh, when he came back at the end there.
Yeah, the 1.2. Then he said yes. Then he said that that's the first year. It was 1.2, 4 years. Then he was happy with that, but then he said Bischoff said after 1.2, 1.3, 1.5, anyway, it went up to many millions. So he was really happy with that deal.
And he ended up saving his money pretty well, didn't he, or something?
He really never changed much. You know, he kept that same house. He was not a big spender. He likes, you know, he works on his, he has a special car that he, it's not like it's a car, it's like a some sort of a Jeep, you know, it puts a real strong engine in it, the tires, and it's, but his best friend is mechanical, so it doesn't cost him that much. The parts, you know, it's like they're babies together, those guys, you know, they just work on the Jeep all the time, and it can make the mud go up 50 feet in the air, you know, it's really, really strong. It's a nice Jeep. It's very, very hot, but wow. Other than that, it's not a big spender.
So just to get back to the Quebecers for a bit, who came up with the music? Was that Jimmy Hart, or was that someone from...
Jim Johnson.
Jim Johnson, okay.
Yeah. I guess on Vince's idea, just to give a receipt to the Mounties, or the Royal Canadian Mounted Police, you know, just saying that we're not the Mounties, we're handsome, we're brave, we're strong. Like... it's a receipt, basically. Yeah.
And you came in with a very strong push, and you won the tag titles pretty quickly from the Steiners.
Yeah, but I have to say that, though. The Quebecers, I think we were really pioneers, inventors, if you want, of the new type of working a tag team in wrestling. I think you saw some move maybe with the Road Warriors. You saw him doing like, you know, put someone on his shoulders and, you know, on clothesline the guy, but that was for the finisher. Maybe you saw the Rockers did a drop to a hold and dropped an elbow, you know, little things, but basically all our moves were like devastating and they were done together, like slam, back jump on top of the guy, together, push off in the air, neck on the top rope, Boston Crab, leg drop from the top rope, the other one where hold him up in the air, come with the crutch in the face, the finisher, the big tower, hands on hands, drop, you know, Quebec bomb, boom. There was not that many moments during a match where you didn't see a real team moves, you know. It was not like, let's say, Scott Steiner had his Frankensteiner, Rick Steiner had his Steiner liner, and like most of our arsenal was based on being a team. And I think a lot of teams kind of copied that after us. I think we really marked the business for tag teams. That's my thought, though, on how we marked the business with the moves that we created. They were really devastating and looking good, and they were we always had to use one and the other partner to make it happen. So we were not doing much by ourselves.
And you beat the Steiner brothers for your first tag team championship reign. What was it like working with the Steiners? Because I know you had a lot of matches with them.
Yeah, it was great. I mean, we did also our first match here at the Montreal Forum against them, and they were real cooperative. you know, they really wanted to have good matches, but they didn't really want to get pinned. That was the main thing, though.
Is that why the Quebec province rules?
Well, yeah, then? Yeah. Then they kind of get a, they kind of got out at the WWF because they didn't want to get pinned by us, you know, because we were supposed to pin them, you know, and they refused that, and that kind of gave them heat with the office.
What was that incident there that you told me about before, where Jacques threw an apple at Scott and it just hit a pole right in front of Scott's head? Yeah. And exploded?
That was during a tour in Germany, where Doink and Dink were there, and Rick and Scott, they taped up Dink around a pole in the dressing room. And just making fun of him because he was, hey, guys, you know, and couldn't get out of there because he was taped with the duct tape, you know. And then they start throwing like some sandwiches and fruits, and, you know, we had a buffet like in the room. So start throwing all kinds of things of the buffet, you know, at him. And yeah, all the boys were laughing at this, you know, because it's pretty funny. But in the meantime, it's a human being there. And Jacques just got, at one point it was enough, so he told the guy to stop it, you know, the Steiner, the guy, stop it, you know, and Rick said, yeah, what you gonna do, you know, so he picked up an apple and threw it as fast and hard as he could. I wish that Rick didn't receive it in the forehead or in the face, because he was going to be hurt, you know. And the pole where Dink was taped up was about that wide, and the apple and his head was behind somehow, somewhere. And anyways, the apple just crashed on the pole, and it was silent for a while, you know, like tension, you know, ooh, something's gonna happen. So, and we're working against the Steiner right after that, you know, the match has not been done yet, you know, so we're going up in the ring, so we're like, the adrenaline is there for the four of us, because you give your body to the other guy, and you just had a big argument and almost threw an apple on the forehead of someone and almost fucking knocked him out. And now you're working with him and you give him your whole body. The guy can break you an arm or a shoulder or anything.
They're both NCAA wrestlers.
Yeah, or whatever, yeah. So I was on the apron. I let them start. Rick and Jacques just waiting for the rumble to explode and just getting to jump into the action and fight for real, you know. But I guess Jacques was respected pretty much.
Was that pretty much the only problem you had with him, and it was cool after that?
No, we had another problem with the Steiners and Ludwig Borga one time. Just after we got the straps, the tag team championship, tag team belts, We came to a TV tapings, and someone came up to us. Can't remember who it was. Hey guys, your Cadillac had four flat tires. So someone had done our tires. So they were saying maybe it's the Steiners. They had big rivers back then. Perfect was one of them. It was good to steer shit, you know, Kurt.
Yeah, he caused the whole announcement.
yeah.
Supposedly. We've had other people tell us that Kurt just took the heat for it and it was actually dynamite.
So yeah.
There's no one really knows because Kurt's passed away.
Yeah, that's it. But I can tell that Kurt was, like, when he was the first one to know that we were getting the titles, like, oh, guys, got a big scoop for you, so you'll be the next tag team champion. So Kurt came up to us at the restaurant and told us so. And he was like, you know, making a little bit of sauce on it. Yeah, make it like a big deal. And so like, oh, we see who's got the push here, you know, things like that. A little bit like, the four tires, it ended up, at the end, it went from being the Steiners to being Ludwig Borga. And, Jacques told Borga, come outside, we gotta talk. And he asked Borga, did you slice the fucking tire? And I was just beside Jacques, just in case something happened. I was there outside, and Borga said, no, I didn't. So if he did, he didn't back up his
So basically what happened, someone sliced your tires.
The four.
And
the
there four was rumors that...
It was the Steiners. And then it went from the Steiners to being Ludwig Borga. And confronted Borga, and he said it wasn't him. And so we can really...
Borga wasn't known as a guy that would have done something like that, though, is he?
But he was like a Nazi. He was like, didn't like the blacks, didn't like...
Oh, so he may not have liked French people.
Yeah, maybe so. And plus, he was a good friend of Polo.
Oh, of course. And I just have to ask this, because I'm fighting Rick Steiner coming up here on November 5th in Hawkesbury. What's your advice for me to prepare for that match coming up against Rick?
I think he's going to be all good. I mean, even his Steiner liner, like I took it so many times. It's just the way you bump, you know. It's like it looks so amazing. It looks so good, but it doesn't hurt that much. Like he's really pro. Like everything he does, he's pretty light. You know, I really like Rick. I mean, Scott too. Like, for having matches. I've had some of my best matches with Rick and Scott. I respect their work a lot. I was a big fan of them when they were in WCW, a big fan of Scott with Frankensteiner. I took it so many times. I think I made the Steiners look really good. I took all kind of their things. I took that. With Rick, you know, you go up to the top rope, you go for a double axe, he grabs you, he gives you that belly-to-belly side suplex. I mean, they're great to work with. They're great workers.
And your second reign, you defeated the 1-2-3 Kid and Marty Jannetty. What were those two like to work with?
Yeah, it was good. It was good. Even though Marty was always like kind of making fun of Jacques a little bit, calling me again.
Yeah, because Jacques told us there was some past heat with Shawn Michaels and Jacques or something, and Jacques had to have a talk with him or something.
Yeah, probably. Yeah. I know. Like Marty was always trying to, you know, rib Jacques as much as he could. You know, he wasn't going too far, but he was, you know, saying Jacques like he was throwing up. You know, but. That was about it. But match-wise, we did the Madison Square Gardens in New York against them. And then the match didn't came out like the office would like the match to come out. But when we did the Raw, it was an incredible match. It was a part where they think they would win. Because Jacques put his foot on the second rope, and then we get the 1-2. They get the 1-2-3. They win. They go. They celebrate with the fan and the bleachers and all over the seats in the arena. They go up in the air and they come back down. And now they reverse the decision because after watching the replay, they're saying that Jacques got his foot on the rope, so the count doesn't count. We have to restart the match. And then we restart the match, and then eventually I think we won. I'm not sure. I think we won this match. And anyways, it was a great match. And then because we won, we might have lost. I don't know. The three times that we won was the Steiner Brothers on September 13 on Monday Night Raw. Then we lost to 1-2-3 Kid and Marty Jannetty. I think it was on that Raw. We lost the straps there. And they dropped it to Men on a Mission, I think. And anyways, we dropped it to Men on a Mission and regained it from Men on a Mission in the same tour in England. We dropped it in a city. And I don't, and we gained it at the Royal Albert Hall against Men on a Mission. And I think it was the same thing. We swapped the belts with 123 Kid Marty Jannetty. We lost and we gained it from them. We did the same thing with the Men on a Mission. But I don't know if we lost it at the Gardens or we lost, I think we lost it at the Gardens and regained it on Raw.
What was the big issue with Men on a Mission at WrestleMania 10 that eventually led, from what I understand, to
the end of the Quebec? We were going to Vince's office and telling them that the style of our team, even though we were like arrogant tag team, we had devastating moves and people believed in our moves, like from, you know, we wanted a strong victory. Like
you were popular in Quebec too, weren't you?
Popular in Quebec, but I don't think WWF really gives a crap about Quebec. Like, they, not that they don't give a crap about any towns, but...
Well, now they only pretty
they're
much...
They're not he's a hometown guy, we're going to do something special for him. They weren't like that. Like, they used to tell me, you're the same in every city. If you're in Montreal, we'll do the same thing in Montreal that we'll do in Louisiana or in Florida or in Germany. We're not going to change any of our script because the guy is in his hometown, which I don't think it's true, because they did some great things in Texas for Shawn Michaels. They did some great things for CM Punk in Chicago.
Ric Flair.
So
Carolina.
So I think it was all BS there, but that's what they were
telling
me.
Hearts in Calgary.
Yeah, yeah. What was your question?
The whole thing that led into the WrestleMania 10.
Yeah, it was the fact that, we've been going to Vince's office and they promised us that we were getting a big, big win eventually. So like a strong with how we're finished in the middle, 1, 2, 3 with the belts, and really look strong because we had a shaky wins, you know, with the Steiners. We had a okay, like we won the belts on the road in England, which was not taped, and we had a wins against Marty Jannetty and Shawn Michaels, but it was a foot on the rope and this and that. So it was not a real strong win, like, you know, going there with some momentum and having a great pin, 1, 2, 3. And we were looking for that, and we had talked with Vince, and Vince agreed, like, WrestleMania, guys, it's going to be your big, you know, finisher, and 1, 2, 3. So Pat Patterson came to us in the afternoon, and he said, we're going to do a DQ. And so Jacques got all pissed off about it, because... So they lied to us again, you know. They promised us that we're gonna have our biggest win ever, you know, since we have our run with the belts, and it's gonna be a fucking DQ, you know, WrestleMania 10. It's not what it was supposed to be. He said, "I want to quit, man. I'm quitting." I said, "Okay." I said, "You should quit with me. I will go to WCW, but we'll be business. We'll do, you know, we'll even job tonight if they want. But we'll leave after." But you know, me, like, from being a 14 years old kid, you know, always wanted to make it in the WWF. It's easier said than done. So I really didn't want to leave WWF. I felt like I was getting closer and closer. You know, I could have a discussion with Vince anytime that I wanted. His door was always open for me. I was, you know, getting treated good by the office, getting to know everybody, there, and just to start up again with a new company and new people, new bookers, new everything. I mean, I didn't want to do that. So he said, "Since you don't want to quit, we'll start working our angle for the." For the match, the retirement match. He says, "Vince owes me money anyways. I was supposed to make $500,000 this year, and I made just like $300,000, like, so far. He's down, you know, 200. So he said, "I'm going to make like something like a $50,000 retirement match, you know, just so
Was he planning to actually retire at that point, or was that always going to be just a gimmick?
No, I was. He wanted to retire because said that he was fed up with the business and the lies and the politics and all the bullshits and the things that were promised and that was not given and things like that. And he just wanted to get like to the around 350 US, so it would make a 500, half a million Canadian, which was close to what he made against the big bossman the year that he left. So he just wanted to have a huge retirement match and thought he was going to be able to do something else with his life, like radios.
Right, and at that time too, you guys were popular all over Quebec, because you guys in WWE, now they only go to Montreal, very, very rarely Quebec City, but they went to other towns in
Quebec.
Yeah,
we did like Valley Field, we did Drummondville, Sherbrooke, Three Rivers, a bunch of cities, a bunch of towns, so.
So yeah. A lot of those people probably traveled to the big show.
Also that was part of the drawing a crowd for the Montreal Forum. I did this tour against Razor Ramon. I was the heel, Jacques was the face. After, you know, we did the WrestleMania and then we did a few matches against the, dropped the belts to the Samoans, but we did some good match with them. With
the Head Shrinkers.
Head Shrinkers. We did Gatineau. We did, they broke out the flags and everything. That was a lot of heat. That was good. That worked.
That was on Saint Jean Baptiste.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And they broke the Quebec flag in Gatineau. And it was a good house there. And we really got over. That was one of my best souvenirs, you know, like as far as having a good babyface heat. Also, when we dropped the belts in Vermont, that was great. I mean, the tension, the build-up was so great. I mean, it was a hell of a match. And then we did another match here against them where we split. We did the split, me and Jacques. Jacques did the job. And then I shoved him and then blamed him for losing. But we planted the seed at WrestleMania when we went to for a suplexing Big Mabel, like 500 pounds, and then Jacques goes and he hurt his back and I push him and pushed me back. And, you know, we started there to plant the seed of the retirement match because we knew in the afternoon that Jacques was not going to stay. And me, I saw it as an opportunity for me to start my own solo career. So, and not having to deal with always the partner.
So that match in Montreal, I think it was the last actual wrestling sellout at the Montreal Forum.
I guess it was, yeah. Because you had no curtains, you had no big screens for the entrance of the guys, you know, just the small curtain, the screen of the Forum itself, and it was totally sold out.
And the Molson Center opened up a couple of years later.
Yeah, and then it was great because it was 18,500 people, and when you work on top like of Undertaker, of Yokozuna, of Shawn Michaels, Razor Ramon, Double J, Jeff Jarrett, all those great names, and you make the main event there, and you steal the show with it. I mean, it's something that you know, it stays there forever. Like this match is gonna be there. It's a historical, epic match. You know, it's there forever. So. That was supposed to lead to a world title for me in the WWF after
against
that.
Backlund, right?
Yeah, that's it. After that, such a success that Jacques got all fired up. Now, at the end of that match, we make it where Jacques's giving me shit and everything, and I feel kind of sorry, and all the family's there, and all the boys are there in the ring. Razor, they all put Jacques on their shoulders, and he celebrates and everything, and then I ask him to shake hands and forget about the whole thing that just happened, and want to, as a sportsman, congratulate him for his win and things like that. So we shook hands because now we wanted to, because we talked before the show, we knew it was going to be a sellout, And now we wanted to have Jacques as being my coach, my manager, and set out the Olympic Stadium in Montreal, which was the first one who brought out that idea was Dino Bravo, wanted to work Hulk Hogan in the stadium, and Vince refused.
And he ended up passing away too.
Yeah. But when he was there at the end of his career, and he also wanted to have a last match just to buckle the loop, have a retirement match in Montreal.
Because he had a match, in February of 93, right? At the Forum with WWE, just before he was murdered, right?
I thought he was murdered in 92. That's
okay,
I'm not sure.
I just remember seeing a promo that he was coming back, but he looked like he looked a lot different.
Okay.
But
I thought it was murdered in 92 because I never got to meet him. I never met him. You know, I've heard a lot of stories about him from Jacques and Raymond. And Ricky was traveling on the road with us too, because Ricky came back in 93 for, he had a run with Razor Ramon for the IC Intercontinental title, which lasted like a few months, and after Ricky was the TV champion in WCW.
Yeah, so, he got a good deal in WCW.
Yeah, yeah, so Ricky was doing good in WWF while we were there in singles.
What did you hear that the killing was about with Bravo from your sources?
Cigarette smuggling.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's for sure, that's what it is, but we don't know the reasons. The real reasons why.
Because the thing was, they were cheaper to buy in the United States at the time, and there was a whole thing going on with people smuggling across the river, I guess.
Yeah, the story I heard that this was just shipments that was stealing away from him, and that's a lot of money, so they were probably wondering if he was not stealing the shipment himself and selling and making money out of it, because he had a big rhythm of life. Like, he had like a million-dollar house and huge cars, and you know, like, he was spending a lot of money, because when they fired him, he was at his top. He just got out of a run with Hulk Hogan, so he was making tons of money from making no money. So I really don't know. Like, it was so many people involved in that thing. There's rumors that the safety, the big safety box, only one person knew the number, and it was opened after he got shot. And so, was it a friend who came with someone? Was it the friend who shot him? Was it? It's a lot of unknown things. Is it true that he was stealing his own shipments to make more money? Is that the real story? Did he had an argument because he had a temper too? So maybe he had a big argument with some Italians that didn't like the way he reacted. Because if you remember, like, I heard a story, Michel Bergeron was the coach of the Quebec Nordiques. Okay, Dino was sitting behind him on the first row at the Forum during a hockey game, and he wanted to go down and beat fucking Michel Bergeron. And everybody was stopping him. He was getting, like, throwing people out and going downstairs, and Bergeron went white, you know. He was scared. He was telling the story on TV, so, and he snapped on a bus driver one time, Dino, so. Who knows, you know, maybe it's not about yes, he was smuggling cigarettes, that's the shoe, and
could have snapped on the wrong person.
Yeah, maybe. So we don't know. We don't know what happened.
So I guess Bob Backlund ended up losing the title to Kevin Nash.
Yeah, in 12 seconds at the Gardens.
I heard Backlund say, though, too, he was supposed to have a longer run initially, but they wanted a babyface champion for some reason.
Yeah. Us, like me and Jacques, we just wanted to have the title for, like, you know, we just wanted to sell out the, all the arrangements were made. Like, Jacques already called the Régie des Installations Olympiques, the Rio, you know,
yeah.
The management of the Olympic Stadium. had dropped the deal from the rent from 275,000, I think, to $125,000 for the rent. Just called Vince, you know, Vince, I got a hell of a deal with the Olympic Stadium. It's gonna cost a lot of, it's not gonna cost a lot of money. I reduced the deal, and Vince was there. Yeah, man, Jacques, it's good. We're gonna go there. He agreed on a lot of things, you know. Yeah, we're gonna do that. Carl's gonna go against Backlund for the title. You'll be in the corner. Blah, 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 blah. So 2 weeks after, Jacques calling the office. I'm waiting on the, listening on the other line at his house. Vince is on the line. So Jacques says, what about the Olympic Stadium? What is the date? You know, have you come up with a date or something so we can start promoting this thing? So Vince says, well, Jacques, we're not gonna go there anymore. So Jacques, why? You know, Jacques started to get pissed off. Well, I said, I just lost Randy Macho Man Savage to WCW, and I don't think we got what it takes to sell out a big venue like that. Yeah.
That's what Backlund said, actually. That was the reason why he had to drop the strap to Nash, because they wanted to create a new baby fit.
Yeah. So he said, we don't have what it takes now. We just lost Savage, you know. We don't have enough talent to sell. He said, and then Jacques says, yeah, but wrestling is popular in Quebec. We just did 18,500. Me and Carl, you know, we're gonna do it. We're gonna do the stadium. He said, no, Jacques, wrestling ain't popular. WWF is popular. And he said, by the way, I own Pierre Carl Ouellet, you know, so you can't go with him. I own him. He said, well, he said, okay, then. He said, if I don't go with you, I'll go with Hulk Hogan. And he hangs up, you know, but he was more arrogant than that. I'm just saying some of the lines that went through the phone, but Vince changed his mind, you know. He agreed, then he changed his mind, and Jacques really didn't take it, and that's why later on you saw Jacques and Hogan, you know, at the Molson Center.
But in reality, with the combination of WWE's promotion and the popularity of the Rougeaus and how popular you were at the time, you probably could have had a very big
crowd. Maybe 25, 35, 40,000 people for because we were on the front. Because you have to take in consideration that it was the baseball was on strike and hockey was on strike. So newspapers, radio, TVs, yeah, nothing to talk about. They were talking about us. I was the front page of the Journal de Montréal. I was the front page of the La Presse. I was the front page of the Gazette. I was the back page, the inside back page of all of those papers too, and Jacques too. So all the city was talking about was me and Jacques. So we would have done good, you know? We would have done good, but it just didn't want to change their plans, have like PCO, world champion of the WWF, for maybe 2 or 3 days, you know, maybe drop it to Nash at the Gardens, you know, just later on. So it would have gave me the taste, you know, and also we would have had accomplished something very big, you know, by almost selling out the Olympic Stadium or putting like 40,000 people in it. Because I worked against Hedge at the Dome in Toronto before they changed it, before the name of the Rogers Stadium. It was the...
Yeah, the Sky Dome.
The Sky Dome, me and Hedge, was 41,000 people there.
Was that a Raw?
Yeah, no, it was a house show.
Oh, really? Wow.
Yeah, and I made the Toronto Sun middle page, me and Hedge. Color print.
That was in the late 90s, I guess.
Yeah, it was just at the beginning of Hedge. Yeah.
So is that fallout with Jacques there? Is that when they said, okay, we're going to go with a different gimmick for Carl than let's come up with...
Yeah, well, I already started to put some scenarios down on a book, you know, really professionally done for Vince and Jim Ross and the office there and the writers. And for me, the pirate, I didn't want it to be a cartoon. They changed it a lot. I didn't want it to be the Lafitte name, you know. I was hoping to keep my name. And all I wanted to be is be a guy with an handicap, a little bit like Zach Gowan. It's not the same in I, but it's, you need quite a lot of, to work on different other aspects to be able to work in the sports, you know, without people telling that something is missing on you. So I wanted to do things with handicapped people and work with them and do things with them and do some charity and level, you know, go as far as possible as a heel and just eventually turn out as a face and work the handicap more than the character. And they worked more the character than the handicap. At the end, people didn't even know if I was really blind for that eye or didn't really care, yeah, because they didn't put any sympathy on that. They didn't show any, they could have shown a surgery. They could have done someone hurting me more on this eye. They could have burned me on the eye. They could have, you know, worked the sympathy.
Yeah, explain the reason why.
Yeah, work the sympathy out of that eye.
You didn't have the
patches,
the Quebecer.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So suddenly
it happened with a patch. Just work something out. And, you know, it's always a surgery that you can make. They could have made a strabism surgery and then just make it look like part of the storyline and really go with it. But it depends how much you want to spend on an angle and how much you believe in it. But they believed in me as a worker because I've done the main event of the Forum, you know. I've done some main events with Brett down the line. And they knew I could, be a good main eventer.
Yeah.
But I just think it was a sloppy sloppy idea the way it turned out to be. It's not the way I envisioned my character.
But you went undefeated for 8 months, and I guess you're probably best remembered for your feud with Brett. That coincidentally, it was all about you stealing Brett's jacket, I guess.
Yeah, which Brett talks about in his DVD, Brett's Dungeon DVD.
Oh, I haven't seen that.
He said it was probably one of his lamest angle. Because he says, I have to correct Brett on that though. He says, well, if someone steals my jacket, why wouldn't I get another one made? In the meantime, it's like if I skate with my pair of skate for 10 years or 5 years and someone steals my skates, I don't want a pair of new skate. You know, I want my old skate that I used to perform with.
Yeah.
It's like, it's luck, it's whatever, it's your sweat that is in this jacket, it's the jacket that made you who you are. It's not just having a new jacket, but the way he saw it was lame because it didn't make sense for him to not get another jacket. And in the meantime, you have to think, if I steal your jacket, your ring entrance jacket, and I make my own entrance with your ring entrance jacket, that should piss you off too.
Yeah.
Because I'm taking your jacket and making my jacket and making my own entrance with it. So I think the storyline was not that lame, but in his mind it was lame. But he liked our matches because he put me on his DVD. And I have a tremendous respect for Brett.
And I heard you say before that he was really into planning the matches out, calling you ahead of time.
It's crazy, crazy. Brett was crazy. He was giving me his phone number, and when we had a pay-per-view match, we had In Your House, we had Raw, we had a few important matches together, and I was calling the house, and Brett was picking up the phone, and we were, you know, shooting some of the spots that we wanted to do on the phone, and let's say, let's sleep over it and talk about it again later, and let's sink it, you know, let it sink, and things like that. And when I was not having an angle with Brett, I was trying to call him for other things. Brett was in super shape. Brett was on a treadmill. Brett was swimming in the pool. Brett was jogging. Mm-hmm. Brett was he was not available at all. But for our match, he was always available.
And of course, another huge match you had, I guess, and feud, mini feud you had in Canada was your house show feud with Kevin Nash, but I guess during this time when you were Jean Pierre Lafitte, that's when this whole the whole clique era was going on, right?
Yeah. It was what really got me worked up. It's that's kind of a long story because prior to that, and the year before, just before I started to be Jean Pierre Lafitte, Vince told me, "You know what we're gonna do with you, Carl? We're gonna make you wrestle only in the States for 2-3 years. You're not gonna come back in Montreal ever. People will want you to come back. People will really want you. And then we'll give it to them, you know, what they really want. But we'll make them wait 2-3 years. So, I haven't started the gimmick yet, and I'm on a time off because I'm letting it grow my hair and start, you know, thinking about what we were gonna do with the Lafitte, the pirate gimmick. And then he calls me himself from in their brain, says, "Hey, Carl, Vince McMahon on the phone." "Oh, yeah, Vince, how are you?" I says, "Mike Rotundo just got injured, IRS. I would really like you to take his spot, you know, be working the semi-main events against Sean at the Forum and things like that. And how do you feel about that?" I said, "Yeah, man, I'll do it. No problem." So get to the Forum. Then let's say where this shit started with the click, because that was even before my
and the
push.
Click, just for people that don't know, it was Shawn Michaels, Kevin Nash,
1-2-3 Kid.
1-2-3 Kid, Triple H,
Aldo,
Montoya.
Yeah. A little bit, yeah. Five guys. Nash, Al, Michaels, the main three. Then 1-2-3 Kid, Aldo, Montoya.
And later Triple, because Triple H was friends with you earlier.
Yeah,
on, right?
When Triple H came in the WWF, I was traveling with him for his first month. We were really friends, like even for a longer time than that, because we were coming towards our 7-8 months around that time, and he knew that I was gonna work Brett eventually. He didn't know that I was gonna work Kevin Nash at the Forum, but he knew something was coming up against Brett, and he was telling me in the car. We were traveling together in the same car in the Bronx in New York. We had a little tour there. And he says, "We'll see, buddy, who's going to end up flat on his shoulder first, me or you." So just as a joke. So we had like a little bet, friendly bet, who was going to...
Because we were both undefeated.
So who was going to be the first one to get pinned, you know? And he was thinking it was going to be me. So he wasn't that close with Vince at all. Even I had a meeting with Vince, and I told him about the fact that Paul Levesque was coming from, which is Triple H, was coming from WCW, and he had the same gimmick as me with the long boots. And Vince got like kind of got pissed at me. He said, "Carl, I just told you I was gonna take his boots off him and give it to you." So he was always making me feel important, you know, in his eyes. So
are you surprised, just before we go on to that click story, like how now he's one of the most powerful men in wrestling and became a big superstar?
I'm surprised. I'm happy for him, but I wouldn't change my place for him. I mean, he's living under tremendous pressure, I guess. It must be tough to be son-in-law of Vince McMahon, you know. You don't have a large margin of error, you know. I guess he's so passionate about wrestling. I mean, if they get along good, him, Steph, and Vince, I'm surprised, though, because he didn't have an edge, you know, on me or anyone else. But he went straight up to, and that's not me saying that, that's the Red Rooster. Terry Taylor said, Triple H came up to me. He says, "Who are the guys to hang out with to have success in this company?" And Terry Taylor told them to hang out with Sean, Kevin, and Razor. And he went straight up. I read it in Sean's book. He said, "Hey, guys, can I hang out with you?" Straight, flat out like that. Because he's not a drinker. He doesn't do drugs. So he's, in fact, like he doesn't belong in that clique. Like,
right, he just
by habits, you know? He's the only one that doesn't drink, that doesn't do drugs, that doesn't take pills, whatever.
He didn't gravitate to them for those reasons. Yeah. He did it to help
business
himself.
Wise, business wise, but he got, I guess he made some good friendships with them. So.
And it was a great choice for him in the long run.
Yeah.
So what was the whole issue?
Well,
that
the thing is,
about?
I'm replacing IRS, Mike Rotundo, against Sean, and George the Animal steals the agent, and he's telling me that I gotta do the job for Sean, and like I'm still talking to Jacques a bit, and Jacques is telling me, if you do a job now in Montreal, you're finished, your career's down the drain, you're not gonna be able to be something worth something anymore. So I kind of tell Sean that I don't want to do the job, so he really get pissed off. He says, fuck, man, you're a fucking idiot. He said, just 30 guys just put me over and the Royal Rumble, and you don't want a fucking job for me, and you're sitting at home. And like, then I let it sunk in, talk about it. I said, okay, I'll do it. But then I made a frictions, you know, like for 10, 20 minutes, 15 minutes, because I put the argument that I was not comfortable doing the job for him. I didn't say, like, I'm not going to do it. I said, I'm not comfortable doing it. But it made a little something that wasn't, that stayed there after that, you know. I did it. I slammed him, or the backbreaker. I had one of my best matches ever, by the way. I rate him as the best worker. I mean, him and Brett, they're my two favorites. But Sean's probably the best. I mean, he's so light on everything. I pressed him. I did all kinds. We had a hell of a match. You know, he was really motivated to have a great match. And so anyway, I do a backbreaker on the cement floor. I go to the second row. I do the cannonball. He moves out. I hit the cement floor. Throws me in. He does a slingshot with the feet on the top rope. 1, 2, 3. Beats me like that. So, which is a good, you know, ending and everything, but nobody remembers that today, you know, for the boys at home that cares about doing the jobs here and there sometimes. People don't remember after 2 weeks what happened.
So that kind of initiated the heat?
Yeah, and, it was a little seed planted there as far as heat with the click.
And then?
I don't think about that. Probably nothing came back to Vince that much because I did the job and I did the great match. And it's an awesome match. And I fill out a space, you know, for IRS where I didn't have to do it. You know, I was sitting at home. I said yes to it, you know. So I was being a good businessman. So they rewarded me with 8 months undefeated as the Lafitte gimmick. And then probably Sean had told Kevin about something. And a month before the title match in Montreal, Nash came up to me and says, next month, it's me and you at the Forum. The show wasn't advertised yet. So I figured, how the fuck does he know the finish already? He said, next month, it's me and you, main event. I know nothing.
Because house show matches,
you,
you're not told
it's
that.
It's a house show match. Usually. It's me and you. It's the main event. 8 minutes, big boot to the face, jackknife, 1, 2, 3, my friend. And that worked me up big time. I went up to Sid. I said, fuck, this motherfucker knows that. How can he call me? It's finished right away, a month in advance before the show. Fuck that. I'm not going to do it. You know, he's so fucking arrogant. You know, I hate his fucking guts. A fucking piece of shit, you know, and fuck, I was really, really, really mad at the whole situation. And of course, when that night came in, I totally refused to job against him. And that was like the whole dressing room wanted to fucking stab me, I guess. I don't know, like, everybody came up to me, come on, you gotta be business, gotta do this, gotta do this. I said, no, man. I said, if I'm gonna do this fucking job tonight, might as well just pick up my bag now and just leave and go home. Never come back into this business and you're just gonna jerk off with your fucking main event, you know. So everybody was calling, you know, the agents, higher agents, Vince to the other agents, and trying to talk me into it. And I never wanted to do it. We did the double count out. And I told that story so many times, but when we were walking towards the, I don't know, it's a curtain match, you know, for the boys. Everybody's at the curtain waiting for the fight to explode, you know, because he's 7 foot tall. He should fucking kick my ass.
And he was a, he is tough, really. He was a bouncer for many years before wrestling.
But anyways, we just, we started the match okay. Man, at the end, working towards the curtain, every forearms was stiffer and stiffer and making more noise. And the next day I had to work against him in Quebec City.
But it was cool in Montreal.
Montreal?
Yeah.
I don't know, everybody was on the phone with Vince trying to get me fired.
Oh, after, but like the match itself, there was no...
Stiff.
Yeah, just stiff.
Stiff, but no injured, no injuries. Yeah,
you followed the game plan of the match.
You followed my game plan, yeah. No, it's just, being retired, it's so easy to say. No, but I tried many times... I really thought I made a mistake. Sincerely, it was a big mistake on my part, and I don't want to come off as an asshole, but I was just young, and the glory of the 8 months undefeated went up to my head, and I believed in my own gimmick, and believed in my own push, and I really wanted to be the world champion of this Fed for being at a young age, that I really thought that my time was come. You know, the Olympic Stadium didn't work out. Now I've got a chance to be the champ again in the Forum, in the Colisée in Quebec, and drop it in Toronto on the third night. That come up, that doesn't come again. And and they called me to finish a month ahead of time. From the clique, which I don't like them, you know, because we have an history, and they have history with all the boys, and all the boys hate them because they're braggers, they hold all the belts, they ribs, you know, guys, they do stuff, they get there late, they get there all fucked up, all pilled up, they still have a push, they still have the belts, they do things wrong, you know, they're like, the selective group, you know, who can do whatever they want, but nothing happens to them. So it works out a big kind of jealousy towards them, but they never have any fine, they're never suspended, they never jobbed because they did something wrong. Because they have all the powers, they have all the belts to them, you know, they have the tag belts, they have the IC belt, they have the world title belt. So if they all leave together, the company's crumbling down. So Vince's tied up like that, and I know he is too, you know. That's why I always said when I refused to do the job, it was not against Vince, it was against the clique.
Okay. So what is that what made you eventually switch to WCW pretty soon after?
Had to. But the thing is that when I...
You weren't fired over that?
No, though. Vince says, I handled Carl Ouellet in the meeting. They had a big meeting in Oakland. Vince flew. It was only a 2,000 people gate. He flew there just to meet all the boys. There were nine in the room. They all wanted to get me fired. And he said, no, I handled Carl Ouellet myself. He wanted to give me a break. Probably wanted to do like he did to Triple H when he jobbed for a year in a row because he did the curtain
curtain call
click, you know. So, but I was not gonna get along with that program. I was not ready to job for a whole year or things like that, because you never know where after jobbing so long if you're gonna get out of the company or go back up. So. It was Survivor Series. I was against the 1-2-3 Kid, and I was one of the team. I had, Shane Douglas on my team and two other guys. Anyways, I just pulled out of that Survivor Series. I said I had an injury. which wasn't true. And then Yves, I noticed. Then we worked our way back, me and Jacques, as the amazing French Canadian in WCW. But by the time we got there, Diesel, Kevin Nash, and Razor Ramon got there for NWO, so it was bad timing again.
Why did Jacques, was that all because he wanted the Hulk Hogan match, why he decided to come back?
Yeah, the Hulk Hogan match plus, yeah, he needed money at this time too.
Yeah. Okay, so, and what was with the amazing French Canadian's name?
They didn't want to use the Quebecer's name for lawsuit purposes or the Quebecois name, or I don't know. Eric Bischoff came up with that, or his booker.
So I was there that night for that Hulk Hogan match, and that was a huge match on the card, but the other huge match on the card was you against the Giant, who's the Big Show now.
Yeah, the Big Show didn't want a job for me. I was supposed to get a big win there against the Big Show. He refused, and Hulk agreed to a job for Jacques because historical things too, you know, having the Rougeaus on his cards all the time, having a solid undercard for him, being a main eventer all the time, was important to him, and wanted to salute also the courage of Jacques for facing Dynamite Kid, who was a real bully, who everybody was scared of him, and having the balls to do that, and being there for, you know, in his prime time undercard and all that. So he did that for Jacques, and probably giving a little shot to Eric Bischoff too, telling him that, you know, he was Hulk Hogan and he could do whatever he wanted to do, because Bischoff didn't want that to happen.
No, because I believe you guys lost your very first match against the Nasty Boys, which was your debut match.
Oh, that was another story, because we were supposed to have a big win against the Nasty Boys for our debut match.
It was on Nitro, I think.
And Nobbs, he's very friend with Hogan, and he went to complain, and he was crying at Hogan. Like, I love Nobbs and Sags and Nobbs. We works against them for an Alouette Games, and they jump for us, and they're funny and everything, but whatever they can use that power that they got with Hulk, they did it, and they did it against us, and we lost instead of winning. So our debut was the shits.
Would your highlight in WCW be your match with the Giants? Because I think, a double DQ or double count?
Yeah, no, it was a shitty match.
But would it have been one of your better ones, the Steiner matches that you had there? Or?
Yeah, the Steiners on the World War III.
Yeah.
I think what was,
pay-per-view.
And we had some great match with the Booker T and his brother, Stevie Ray.
Harlem Heat.
They were great. They were good friends of mine. Stevie Ray was a good friend of mine. I got along good with Stevie Ray.
And did you guys just decide to leave and go back to WWE because you didn't feel you were being used to your fullest potential?
Yeah.
So Jacques made the call there.
Yeah.
And you were still called the Quebecers when you came back, but you didn't really have a gimmick, it seemed.
No, I wanted to I kept wanting to put my handicap in there. That was my way to be recognized, to be out of the pack. I just wanted to trademark that, and that didn't work out good because we didn't, like, really gel as the first time as a tag team, you know, like, yeah, we had long hair and
they didn't really put much effort. Didn't you lose your first match back too or something on Raw?
Yeah, I mean, it was also, I think, a little receipt Vince to us for different reasons with him and Jacques. They had a lot of arguments, and when we came back, I felt like it was not the same, you know. Like, when you look at it, you know, backwards, and then you know where you hit your peak, and you always think during your career you're going to hit a higher peak. But when you look at it, when it's all said and done, you know, you saw where the biggest peaks were. And, I mean, obviously we didn't peak there, you know, on the second run.
And I heard you say that Jacques didn't like Bradshaw very much.
No, because one time we were in Winnipeg, I think, We had an analyzed flight, you know, a private flight for just the wrestlers. And there's a van from, let's say, a Holiday Inn van, you know, who comes to pick us up. And Bradshaw just tossed the driver out of the seat and he grabs the wheel and he does like crazy things in the snow. And the guy's from Texas, you know. So Jacques gets nervous because he says, man, I got kids at home, you know. You're from fucking Texas. You're driving in the fucking snow. You don't know what the fuck you're doing. And Bradshaw's having fun. And ha, 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 ha. And he told him, you know, when we get there, if we're in life, man, you're not going to believe it. And then we had a big argument and they almost fought, you know, and fucking Bradshaw just shut up.
And Jacques ended up getting released, or did he quit?
He got released. We were waiting because we signed our contracts on December 30th in 98. So December, there's a window of 4 months every year for the contract to get fired. And the first day was December 99, the 30th. So I don't get my release. I don't get my release. Jacques calls me, says, I got fucking released. I'm out of the company. So I'm waiting the whole time. And so I'm calling the office, see what's going on. And they kept me for another year. And they let him go. And then that's it.
And they didn't do much with you that year, but the one thing that you are remembered for is your infamous Brawl for All match with Steve Williams.
Well, the thing is that not too long after, I did some three training camps at the WWE headquarters in Stamford, Connecticut. And then...
didn't they send you to All Japan or something too?
Yeah, too. And they called me up and they said, okay, next Monday you're starting. That was a Thursday. They called me, Bruce Pritchard calls me. He said, okay, you're going to wear a blue trunk and with the cape like the Dynamite Kid, British Bulldog, and the blue boots, the big fleur-de-lis in the back, and you're starting Monday on Raw. So Friday, I don't have my plane tickets. I call the office and say, I'm supposed to start Monday. It's a change of plan. So things happen like that sometimes. It's pretty
so you almost
pretty
had a
depressed.
Big push.
Almost had a push, yeah.
Yeah. For that Brawl for All match, could you, if you wanted to box, like have a legitimate athletic boxing competition, could you even be licensed with your eye?
No.
So you were, so there was no real, because I guess it was under the pro wrestling.
Yeah, it was no commissions
yeah,
or
no
anything.
Commission, yeah,
yeah, because, and I went with my eye patch too.
Right, because you can't perceive depth for someone that's like, you're very tough, but like to block punches, it's very difficult with one eye.
Yeah, but I guess I threatened, Nash and people, to beat them up. I guess they wanted to see if I had really balls or I just pretended I had balls. Yeah. So they put me with the guy who was supposed to win the whole thing, Dr. Death, Steve Williams. And then Hawk, of the Road Warriors, he came up to me. He said, man, you're going to get killed tonight. He said, I'm going to tell you what. As soon as, you dance a little bit with Steve, and then when he tags you, you just lay down there, you grab your $5,000, and everything will be good. I look at Hawk, I said, are you fucking serious, Mike? You're telling me to fucking lay down with this motherfucker? No, go back and tell him that I'm going to fight everything I've got in myself, and he's in for the fight of his fucking life. Tell him to fuck off with his $5,000. So,
and you went the distance with him.
Yeah, I went the distance.
Despite your handicap.
Yeah.
And despite that you couldn't do MMA or boxing.
I had only 1 week of training. Steve Williams was training for 3 months in Japan and everywhere with different guys at the time and three guys in the meantime and things like that. And if you look at his second match against Bart Gunn, he was winning the whole thing. He was like, he had only 12 seconds to go and he got knocked out there, but he was winning he was supposed to win the whole thing and he was far ahead on points on Bart Gunn on the second match. Bart just came out at the last second because I think it was just a problem, and we all had the same problems. Was our cardio?
Yeah, because you weren't trained like we weren't trained most for people that. Have an 8-week training camp at least.
Yeah, no training camp at all.
And
me, they fucked with me because I brought a coach, an MMA coach, with me because you have the two generic coach that were saying, yeah, you're good, okay, just do this, just do that. But it was generic for every wrestler. They had the same coach, the same two coach for every Brawl for All match. So they didn't have any strategy or nothing at all. So I brought my own coach. They know that I paid for his wrestling airfare, the airfares, the airplane, the tickets, and everything. That I put him in a room. You know, I travel with him. I don't eat at all during the whole day because I'm all stressed up by the match. The adrenaline is there. And at the beginning with the Raw, not at noon when they tell all the match, at 7 o'clock they say, "Oh, we postpone your match for next Monday. It's not gonna be this Monday. It's gonna be next Monday." Well, I spent already $2,000 on the guy, you know, bring him in with me.
Yeah.
So the next Monday, I didn't bring him with me. I said, if I bring him with me again and they postpone the match another time, it's going to cost me $4,000, you know?
Yeah.
So
I guess you were released a while after that.
Well, they sent me to Power Pro and I tried different gimmicks and everything.
How was All Japan for your, when they sent you there?
That's good. That was good. Budokan Hall, like it was like near the semi-main events against Tao Wei. That was, they had me win the whole tour for 30 days, but it was 18 shows in 31 days, in 30 days. I was there for a month, felt a little bit homesick because it's tough. But 18 shows, going over on almost every show except against Kobashi and another... I can't remember his name.
Is that when you got to know Johnny Ace? I think you were friends with him earlier on, too.
No, I really got to be friend with him there. But everybody hated him there because he was like the American booker.
Okay.
And he was also calling a lot of the shots, finishing and finishes and things like that. But I got along good with him. I worked one match against him. We had a good match. And I think all my matches were very good there. I did good. I had Vader as a tag partner, which was a good experience. Vader had a lot of respect for me. Really rated my work pretty good. He liked my work. And we did some great matches together.
And after you were released, you went to ECW for a good little run, and you had a championship match against Justin Credible.
Yeah, that's funny. That was good because I passed Francine through a table. So I think just that and that, having that in the match is really good, you know, really good spice. Really spice it up really good. That was a good, huge pop there, and I came out. I was a little bit afraid of going to the ECW arena because Marty Jannetty went there before, and they were really hard on him. Like they were saying, chanting like, "You're not Sean, you're not Sean," and things like that. They were really hard on him.
Yeah.
And I went there, and as just Carl Ouellet, and man, crowd was on fire. Was electrifying. It was crazy. It was a hell of a show with Aldo Montoya, who was just incredible. So Paulie had a great idea for the match. He really liked me. I got along good with Paulie, but he just ran out of money. So I was just there at the wrong time, you know.
Yeah,
I did, you know, the last bit. They could still use some money. But all the money that he owed me a few shows, and nobody was getting paid and received my check. Even if it was like a month or and a half or 2 months after, I was paid for all my matches and I got all my money from him. So I can't say nothing bad against Paulie.
And it was a bit of a shock that you and Jacques actually returned to WCW during the Team Canada.
Yeah.
Right. How did that come about? It was only for a brief time, but it was so weird to see you guys back.
Can I just check that time?
Oh, yeah.
I'm you have the watch? Yeah, I gotta leave at 7:30. Is it late?
It's 6:30 right now.
6:30. Okay, we got another hour.
Okay. Yeah, there's only a bit more.
Yeah, you want to read?
Okay. I'll ask it again.
Yeah, go for it.
Perfect. You've been giving great answers so far. You ended up going back to WCW during the Team Canada era for Lance Storm's Team Canada with Jacques. What ended up bringing you guys back to WCW?
Well, actually, we didn't know we were going to be back together. Sid got me back there because while I was in Memphis, WCW came for a few shows, and I went to Vince Russo, who I got a good relationship with him in WWF, and he now was the booker in WCW, and Sid just arranged a meeting with me and Russo, and had the chance, and you know, Sid also wanted someone to train with and travel with and things like that, so I worked my deal separately from what Jacques had been working, and they had already brought up Jacques before me, which he did the special guest referee in Vancouver, yeah, which was a great idea.
And it came off well too.
Yeah, with Brett. And then after that, I came into the mix, and it was the first time we arrived to the arena, and we were like not talking to each other for a few years, and start talking, you know, this and that, and we ended up in a gimmick together by not knowing that we were both working on something on
both sides. Didn't know.
Yeah,
so you were
no, he didn't know. I didn't know he was gonna be part of it until I saw on in Vancouver that he was there, but I didn't know I was gonna be part of his deal, or you know, if we had separate deals or whatever. But I was seeing like Team Canada get formed. I imagined that I was gonna be part of it, but I didn't know how it would work. But anyways, it didn't take long that Kevin Nash put the hatchet in that, you know.
I mean, oh, he was booking at the time.
Well, yeah, he had a lot of pulls, you know. Had a lot of pulls, so.
Because Jacques only made like two appearances, right?
Yeah, he quit right away. They asked him to do the job for Ernie Cat, Miller. Yeah. Ernie Cat Miller.
Who was Eric Bischoff's close friend or something?
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. He probably does the DDP yoga now. he quit. He said, "No, I'm not doing the job for the cat, because for him the cat was a job guy," and said, "You know, if we're gonna go that direction, we're not going nowhere." So he left, and I gave it a try. You know, I stayed a little longer, but eventually Nash got rid of me. Like, it's obvious. I mean, they put the strap on me, and then the strap was gone, you know? Like, it was not
a good had the, that's when you had the WCW Hardcore.
Yeah, but it was...
Is there any matches in particular from that era that you look back on with good memories?
No. Even when I dropped the belt to... was the guy who was doing the dance with the
Norman Smiley.
Norman Smiley. I dropped the belt to him, so for a hardcore guy, you know, doing things like that, there's nothing hardcore there, so I mean, I thought it was lame, you know. The booking wasn't that great at the time, so
now, was it Vince Russo booking at that time?
Yeah, but he was kind of booking with a superstar tag team, I guess. You know, like everybody had his word there. Hogan had his word. Nash had his word. Hall had his word. And the Nasty Boys were talking to Hogan. It's free for all, even if it's, Kevin Sullivan was supposed to be the booker. Then it was Vince Russo, then it was another guy, and it changed every week, and you didn't even know who was booking anymore, and then it was just a free-for-all there. And the biggest thing that we did, basically, was to arrive in a big limo, you know, Team Canada, and coming out of a big
limo. I remember that. That was in Kelowna.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
From there you went to TNA later on. What was that like?
That's a good story behind that, because I sent Don Calloway, you know, was coming to work some indies in Montreal, and he was part of TNA. So
Don Callis.
Don Callis. Yeah. Don Callis. Sorry. Yeah.
It's okay.
Which he was supposed to be a former partner of Rick Martel, but Rick had decided to go by himself to WCW and all the work that they did for a year.
Yeah, they were the models, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
They did the work. They worked for a year as the models, and at the last second, Rick, you know, scrapped that thing and went by himself to WCW. Yeah. And just because Don told me that, you know, he was a little bit, not pissed, because he had learned some good experience and it was, you know.
But he never really got over huge.
Yeah, no. But he wished he would have had.
Oh, this comes back to me. They were called the Truth Commission.
Baby.
No, remember Don, you asked me earlier about the military guys.
Yeah,
Don Callis was the manager, the Truth Commission.
Yeah, then okay, he was supposed to be a good talker.
Yeah.
They had him talk for an hour, you know.
Yeah.
He was just talking.
Right.
And nothing was happening.
Okay, so you went to, so Don Callis got you in TNA.
Yeah, I gave him a tape, and he gave it to Jeff, when Jeff knew me.
Yeah.
And my tape was my three-way against Sami Zayn and Kevin Owens.
Okay, so you'd already been training with him.
So this was an amazing, crazy match. That it's on YouTube if people want to see it. PCO against Kevin Steen and El Generico, which is Sami Zayn and Kevin Owens. And the three-way is crazy, and I sent that to TNA. And they looked at it, and right away, Generico wasn't big. Kevin wasn't that big. Like back then, he was probably 220. And
before
Generico,
he went on his McDonald's diet.
Yeah. But at least, you know, he knows it, and he doesn't care about it. But Generico was probably 175. So they saw the match and they figured this guy can work with our guys in the X Division. So went on into a Battle Royal X Division, won the whole Battle Royal. And then what happened next? I had a few matches with different X Division guys. The thing is that they were poor as far as money. And most of the guys were driving all the way from anywhere in Ontario or Ottawa to Scott D'Amore's house. And then they were like driving with a van from Scott to Detroit and flying off Detroit to Nashville on Southwest cheap. But me living in Montreal, there was no way I did it once. I did it once all the way to Scott D'Amore. It was a long way. There was no way I was gonna do that for every Wednesday night. So they flew me straight from Montreal. So my plane ticket was around $500-$600, sometimes $800 plus my payoff. I was costing them a lot of money for the X Division. So after 3 months, I got released. So.
But you ended up working, not with them, but you were the French commentator for TNA for a long time.
Yeah, for almost 5 years.
Yeah.
Until I decided to quit. I was working in Puerto Rico. I think when you came here, you came to Puerto Rico in 2005.
Yeah, I was there
So I started right after Puerto Rico. I met Marc Blondin there. He was on a cruise doing some islands and everything. So I met with him and he asked me if I was gonna be interested of doing that. And I said, yeah, well, I'm finishing here in Puerto Rico. I'll go back in Montreal and I'll do the voiceovers with you for the French commentary and for the TNA shows. And that really got over big in Quebec, the stuff that we were doing, me and Blondin and the TNA. And then after that, I quit by myself because I really wanted another real good shot at WWE. And I went to work back in England for Brian Dixon in 2008.
Yeah, you wanted to go full-time to show
full-time, WWE. And I always had in my mind that if WWE comes to Montreal and I'm from Montreal and I show up at the Bell Center, for them it's just another guy showing up. But if you're from Montreal and they have a show in Birmingham, England, or in London, England, and you show up there, you're busy doing something. You're wrestling every night. So that was my thought. You know, I always wanted to be outside of Montreal to meet them. So I was meeting them in Germany, meeting them in England, meeting them in other places. And that's the way I always thought, you know, just to make it look like wrestling is your full-time job.
And you did have a successful run in Puerto Rico there, working with Ricky Banderas.
Yeah.
And a few others.
I had some great matches there. I really liked it.
Invader
there.
Again as well, from what I remember, right?
Yeah. Mostly Ricky. The whole thing was around Ricky Banderas, their top baby face there. And they had Shane also, Shane Douglas there. But not Douglas,
no,
Shane. He's from Toronto.
The Glamour Boy, who also was in TNA for a bit.
Yeah,
you had a good run there. And then you were also doing, you made up with Jacques, I guess, and you were doing shows for him, and you were helping out at his training school a bit. I remember that.
Oh, that was way before. That was in the year, that's when you first started in the year 2001. That was after I got released in 1999.
Okay.
I helped him out for 2-3 years, but to me, the whole concept of family, no punch, no kicks, didn't make sense. It was just different ideas. I didn't see the business like that. I couldn't do again. I couldn't go against my heart. You know, like what I believe, it's good. No girls, no women's, no tits, no ass, no punches, no kicks. But, you know, it's like Cedric's going to have a tryout in the next NXT.
Yeah, I understand soon he's going to have a tryout, yeah.
He has the look. I heard NXT for September. But it goes against all the principles that he's been preaching for, 15 years.
What was the issue with Jacques and Raymond that caused them to have a little bit of a separation?
I guess Raymond, I get along very good with Raymond, and Raymond is more of the less emotive, if you want, you know, thinkful, you know, he's gonna think more, like before he does some moves, not as emotional as Jacques. Jacques is very emotional, you know, he gets carried away by his ideas, he gets really into it, pumped up and everything, and he does things quickly sometimes. And Raymond has all the money too, because he's been investing, you know, in real estate since the age of 17, since his first pro wrestling match. And he has a lot of money, and I know that Jacques wanted to borrow money from Raymond many times to promote wrestling. And the family told Jacques not to get involved with wrestling promotions because it was a good chance to lose a lot of money. And he did it anyways, and he had at a moment like a few houses. And he had to sell them to pay the boys and pay, you know, whatever happened with wrestling. And he always went against the advice of the family. And I don't know what was the main thing that really made Raymond saying that he was not gonna talk to Jacques anymore. Can't remember the real things, but it was always some kind of a dysfunctional harmony between the two brothers. And but they do conventions still. I mean, they'll be side by side, they'll sign a picture, they'll sign a picture, but they don't really talk to each other. But they'll go. They'll go to conventions.
And you brought up Kevin Steen. Do you want to just talk about your memory? Because you were with him pretty much from the time he was starting with Shock 2 up until he was signed. You were working with him here and there. So you want to just give us your thoughts on him and your experiences with him?
Kevin Steen called me one time. He was a... Shock had told me that this kid started at 14 years old. He was doing all kinds of flips when he was that young, and he was really talented, and Jacques could see talent in him. And Jacques was telling me about how great he was. And at one point, Jacques wanted to have all his wrestlers signed up for competitive, you know, so that you couldn't work for another company. A little bit like Vince does, you know, like you would have to ask for a release if you want to work for another company. Yeah. Or it's a special clause that it says that you can only work for the Jacques Rougeau shows promotion and no other shows. You exclusive to that company. So Jacques had promised Kevin that he would get a tryout. He would give him a tryout, but under Jacques' conditions. And Kevin called me and he said, "Carl, I have to ask you for an advice because I don't want to be exclusive to Jacques because he doesn't run that much. He runs maybe 10 shows a year." And he said, "I cannot really learn the wrestling because, you know, no kick, no punches. All the match are pretty
choreographed
before, you know, we get into the ring, so we can't really call it on the spot or add things or take off things by the feeling that we got off the crowd or feeding off the crowd and adding things and doing more things. And it's pretty much set up in a block, you know." So he said, "I want to increase, you know, my knowledge as a wrestler. I want to be better. I want to get better. I want to be able to work where I want, wherever I can have a match." He said, "Do you think if I don't sign with him, I'm going to be done with wrestling? I'm never going to have a tryout match." And I told him, I said, "Kevin, I said, if you believe in yourself and if you really are as good as you say that you are and that you really want it as much as you say that you want it, it's not Jacques Rougeau or anyone else on this planet that's gonna stop you from realizing your dream. If you really want it, you're gonna have it, but you have to really work for it and you have to do everything that you have to do to achieve that." So he went on and he signed with IWS, but it was not exclusive, so he could go work anywhere. And eventually got hooked up with CZW in Philly and from different other indies in the Northeast in the States, and ROH, Japan, Europe. And then it's how it happens. It's the same thing for me. Like once I was in Germany, and I was on the same tapes of Chris Benoit, Owen Hart. You know, they were all working for Otto. And then when I worked for Otto, I was realizing that Chris Benoit, Owen Hart, Vader, Hawk, Jimmy Snuka, they all worked for Otto Vance, and I was working with them for Otto. And then you realize that your friends suddenly are making it to WWF. And then you realize that it's possible for you because not too long ago you just worked with them into another company, whatever it was in England with Fit Finlay, whatever it was with Steve Regal in England or in Germany. And for him it was the same thing. He start seeing his friends making it there, and they start realizing, hey, if they can do it, I can do it. And then you start to get your confidence boost up, and then eventually it's your people that are there.
And so I guess you're pretty happy with all of his success, because I know you worked with him a lot. And for Sami Zayn, what are your thoughts on him?
He never asked for that many advices. The only thing he asked me for, he says, Carl, I really didn't have a trainer. So when Bill DeMott asked me who trained me, he said, I said your name, do you mind? I said, no, I don't mind, because I worked so many times with you that I kind of trained you in a way, you know, so it's kind of the truth, but I didn't take you from point A to Z, but let's say from M&M to Z or whatever, but he really is, wrestling runs through his veins. I mean, he's all about wrestling. He's all crazy about it. I mean, this guy, he can have nothing to eat and have a ring and he'll be happy. He can sleep under the ring, he can sleep in the ring van, you know. It doesn't take much for him to be happy as long as he wrestles. So I knew that if he had a little opportunity to make it, he was gonna make it. But I was afraid that only Kevin was gonna make it and not maybe Sammy. Not because Sammy is not more talented or better, because I've seen guys. When I was in Power Pro, that guy, I always talk about him. He was so talented. His name was Steve Bisson. And he was from New England, I guess, somewhere, Boston. And he trained, I mean, they were together, him and Kurt Angle. He trained, he showed everything. He showed everything to Kurt, like psychology, making a good match, every single thing. He had three or four tryouts with WWF. He had the KWF, when he was young, Kids Wrestling Federation. He was organizing wrestling in the every high school with rings and everything. He had the promotions. The teacher would let him do that. He had like good houses. He was really into wrestling young. And he never got a break, and I never figured out why. You know, there's stories like that where you see guys, they don't make it. Like Chris Benoit took him, like, he had three tryouts with WWF, never made it. He went to WCW, they put him with the Horsemen. Then after Vince hired him and gave him a big push. But three times they turned a page on him, you know.
And speaking of people that haven't had the WWE chance, what are your thoughts on your matches that you've had with me and working with me in the ring as Hannibal over the years?
I think you've been working your ass off to get there. I think you've been showing like passion. You've been showing like some, I mean, you've been through some adversity that everybody would have quit a long time ago, and to see you still there and still loving it and wanting it, I don't think it's over, you know. I think you may have your chance one day.
And before we wrap things up, you had a bit of a strange tryout with WWE for your last tryout. Yeah. I think you were wrestling Charlie Haas, and you were supposed to have 2 days of tryouts, and it got cut off. Yeah. Do you want to just go over that whole situation?
But the whole thing is also, I kept, you know, it's like every time I showed up to a tryout after, let's say, 2000, nobody remembered me, not because they don't remember, because I was not going to say, yeah, I was Pierre of the Quebecers, blah, blah, blah. Like, Ricky Simbo didn't know who I was, or all the new agents that were there that weren't there when I was there. You know, they saw a kid come out, you know, like, not that I look like a kid, but, you know, someone getting a tryout. They don't know he's a former tag team champion. He's a former WCW guy. He's a former main eventer at the Montreal Forum or a Molson Center. Or they don't know, like, nobody knew me apart from Vince and Pat Patterson. All the other agents, they just took me as someone who was trying to make it into the business. So when I was giving my ideas about what we should do during the match, it was like, nah, that's not good. That's not gonna work. And Charlie Haas knew who I was. He says, yeah, I'm gonna give you a job here. You'll see. We'll have a hell of a match. But the whole day, you know, I was running after him to get a, 2 minutes with him to call, you know, to try to get some spot into the match. And well, I said, okay, I'm going to do some MMA stuff. Oh, okay, I'm going to use my kick, you know, my Muay Thai. So every time I was trying to implant something new, and he was coming back with something on his own that was better than mine. So it was a big ego thing, you know, and he had a job. He got let go not too long after that. He was complaining, oh, we don't have the right referee. We should have the small guy. This guy is too tall. I got to arrange things with my wife. It's not right the way that they're treating me. So he's having a bad day, Charlie Haas, you know. I don't blame it on him. He's just having a bad day. And me, I'm really, really, like, when I'm having a match, I really like, you know, to make sure that we're on the same page and everything's gonna go smoothly and good, you know. And he's never available. And I came out, had a good haircut, I thought, you know, really nice, like some slides, some mohawks, some blonde and everything. And just before I get into the ring, he says, John Laurinaitis came up to me, says, Carl, here, I'm going to help you out. He says, Vince really hates you, UFC, and he thinks your haircut looks like a job guy, so we're going to shave your head. And that gave me a slap in the face just before going into the ring, because I thought my look, all the boys, Jericho, everybody that knew me, they went like, fuck, it's looking good, you know. And of course, you know, we on the way to having my hair cut, we cross Dave Finley, which we never really got along that great, you know, because the first time that me and Nelson, Veillou were in England, you have Dave Taylor in the front, Dave Finley driving, me and Nelson in the back. We don't know we're speaking French the whole way. They get pissed because they don't know what we're saying. If we talk about the other boys, whatever, we get tons of heat, you know, for speaking French in the territory. So after we knew that we had picked up a lot of heat, we started speaking English to each other. But it's funny when you're two French guys speaking in English. But I never, you know, I never, even when I was working for Otto, I always felt like with Finlay was not clicking that much. It was okay, you know, good jokes, good everything, but a little something was missing there. So we went by Finlay. Hey, Dave, what do you think of his haircut? Oh, he looks like a mullet, you know. So it was just like, you know, kissing Johnny's ass.
Finlay had a mullet for his entire career.
I know.
Career in WCW. Kind of
like kissing Johnny's ass a little bit there, so it didn't help my cause, you know. Nobody stood up for me, so I had to shave my head. And fuck, it was because I came up with a big angle for me and Sean. So at the curtain, where's the gorilla position? You had Shawn Michaels, Vince, Pat Patterson, John Laurinaitis. Was a huge fucking table with big names on it.
And you're all there to watch your match.
Yeah, watch my match. And the beginning, the MMA stuff that I really want to implant in the match, you know, I held my ideas. They weren't good ideas. But, you know, it's something like, if you have a feel for something and you don't do it, you're gonna regret it. If you go and do it and it doesn't work, at least you've tried them, you know. You're not gonna have regret. You're not gonna regret them. But I was going against the waves too. Like, everybody was saying, no, it's not gonna work. I thought it was gonna work, so I wanted to do it. But I don't think that Charlie Haas made it look good either. So after 5 minutes, you know, they start calling, they go home. So I had to get, I got 2-3 good moves in there, like a spinning elbow in the corner. But then I met with John and said, Carl, what do you think of your match? I said, to be honest, it wasn't good. It was pretty bad, except, you know, two or three things that were looking good. Bobby said, there's no need for you to come to Philly tomorrow. We'll just take the car and drop it in Montreal. So I drove from Connecticut in the reservation there. What's the name of the reservation?
I don't know. Oh, Mohegan Sun.
Mohegan Sun.
Yeah.
Arena.
Yeah.
All the way to Montreal Airport. It was like 20 hours. You have time to think, you know. It's a slap in the face. It's a kick in the ass. It's pretty depressing, you know. It's this business, you know. You have to be strong mentally, you know, because you're going from some fucking crazy highs to some fucking crazy lows. You know, it's a roller coaster life like you cannot imagine. That's why so many guys are dead. Suicidal, they can't cope with life anymore because they live so much adrenaline, so much frenzy, so much craziness, you know, so much energy, positively great and good, that you can lift a roof, and then the next Monday you're reading on Raw what's going on, and you're depressing, you know, it's nothing's gonna happen, or, you know, you're going down the drain and there's nothing for you. So I remember sometimes being like weeks, you know, waiting for phone calls, like while I was in Power Pro in Memphis, wrestling in front of 25 people in different gymnasiums. And It's just tough going from wrestling in front of 20,000, 40,000, 60,000 people, and then after wrestling in front of 25 people, 50 people, and the payoff changes too, you know, making 25,000 for one match and then making 250 for one match, or $500 for one match, you know. It's I'm doing well financially, so that I don't have to go on convention shows and sell my pictures and, you know, do things like that for some bucks, you know, like so I'd rather just, you know, I ask for big money when I do wrestle, but I don't wrestle much because, you know, it's tough for the promoters to extend good money, you know.
Yeah, because the business is not in its peak right now, unfortunately.
Yeah.
And how do you want to be remembered by your the wrestling fans out there?
Well, I just not the inventors, not me, kind of an inventors of the new tag team way of wrestling, and pioneer of the wrestling, tag team wrestling division. You know, I think me and Jacques, in a short period of time, we really made it good. And I invented a lot of things that you see and you take it for granted today. Like I was the first one, like people were throwing each other in the steel steps, but I was the first one who busted it and separated the two parts, you know, like having the top going from the bottom. And then you see that more often, and now they're using more the steps. You know, I was one of the first wrestler to use things that were making noise and that would make a good show around the ring. Also the cannonball, who changed it into the swanton and you know, that other wrestlers are using in the different ways, but it's originated from the tower into the cannonball into, you know. So I see a lot of things, and also I brought up a lot of ideas to Vince for my own gimmicks that they didn't use, but they use with other guys.
Like the KO.
KO.
You were going to be KO Carl Ouellet.
Yeah,
right?
Because now, I wanted to. The thing is, I wanted to speak to Kevin Owens about it, But my thoughts, what I gave to WWF as idea, is when I was going to use the lariat, I was going to KO the guy, and I was not going to pin him for the count of three. It was going to be a count of 10, like a knockout. I was just going to knock out people on every show. And eventually, someone would get up at 8 or at 9.5, and that would make a fucking match there. That was that the idea I threw for me and Sean, him with the kick and me with the knockout. But my thing was going to be a job guy who nobody knows who it is, and not music, no music, no nothing. I'm in right in the corner. A star comes in with his music and everything. The match is not too long. Boom, knockout. I don't cover. 8, 9, 10, he's out. That's good. That was going to be the gimmick KO, Carl Ouellet KO. And then eventually, the guy that you pick to do the big thing, he gets up at 9.5 and the match continues. He's the first one to break up your knockout things. That would be a WrestleMania match, you know. And that's my idea, was the $1 million match. You know, the winner of the match gets $1 million. And all about the kick, the swing chip music,
sweet chin music.
Yeah, swing.
And any message to your fans here to close things off?
Thanks for, I would like to say to all my fans, you know, thanks for the support. Thanks for all the memos, the pictures that I received throughout the years. And even like every day, there's someone coming up to me and talking to me about a certain match or telling me a certain things about what happened during this year or that year, or when I did this or that. Just want to say thank you to all of you for being there and being part of my history there and the things that I took part of. You were there with me, you were part of this moment, and you are in my heart, and I love you all.
Very good, thanks a lot.
It's a pleasure.